And to tell you the truth, behaviorism had wild success. It gave us insights that still today inform, help us shape behavior when we want it to. When people try to quit smoking, for example, behaviorist principles come to the rescue to help us figure out how to break people's addiction and reliance on substances. When it comes to combating phobias, like claustrophobia or fear of elevators or fear of spiders, behaviorist principles help us do that. So it was wildly successful. However, if, like me, you're interested in understanding things about the human mind, about how we remember things, about how attention shapes what we perceive, about how our interpretations of each other's behavior affects why we do or don't get along, then behaviorism just isn't going to cut it. It's not satisfying. You need to start developing a way to measure the internal mechanisms, the internal processes of how the mind deals with information. And that is what cognitive psychology is all about. The question is, how do you do that? I mean, in all of our experiences, it's almost, your experience might be the same as mine. It's almost as if the thoughts that other people are thinking are invisible, are beyond the scope of our ability to measure it. Well, the challenge of forming a scientific field of cognitive psychology came down to figuring out methods that would allow us to get insight into these otherwise invisible processes. So during the time that behaviorism was ascendant, questions about the inner workings of the mind were largely off the table. And so the one question is, what happened? What is it that allowed cognitive psychology to emerge as a field, to enable those of us who really are curious about what's going on inside here to get a foothold? And to start carving out a respectable niche in the field of research psychology on our own. Well, it turns out that it was a combination of factors. So little by little, findings emerged within the field of psychology that simply could not be explained without some reference to internal mental processes. And that came hand in hand with findings and discoveries that lay outside the field of psychology in fields like linguistics and computer science that sort of showed that the study of how we process information can be a fruitful avenue of research. So for example, as an example of a kind of finding that could not be explained without reference to the mind, we can think back to the work of a famous behaviorist named Edward Tolman. A lot of Edward Tolman's research involved having rats run through mazes and seeing how they learned a maze as a function of the kinds of rewards and treats that they got along the way. But he started to come out with findings that suggested that they were performing in ways that could not be explained simply by reward associations. So for example, in one classic experiment, he ran three groups of rats through a maze. One group of rats, he had just navigate freely around a maze. And he placed some treats at the end of the maze. Another group of rats, he had just explore the maze freely, but there was no treat at the end of the maze. as you can imagine, those rats that had the treat at the end learned to navigate the maze more quickly than those who didn't have a treat at the end of the maze. But there was a twist. There was a third group of rats. Now, these rats just freely explored the maze for the first 10 days, and then at the end of the 10th day, some treats were placed at the end of the maze. And what happened was that the rate with which the rats then learned to get to the end of the maze was much quicker than the rats that had been rewarded with the treats all along. What this suggests is that during the time that those rats were freely roaming the maze, they were learning something about its spatial layout, even in the absence of a reward at the end. This is something called latent learning. And it suggested that there is something going on in the mind. It's something in some spatial representation of the environment that gets developed in the absence of these kinds of reward and punishment associations that the behaviorists swore by. In another famous experiment, he had rats start at a beginning of a maze, and then they learned to go through an arm of the maze to get to a treat. And they learned that very quickly. But then what he did is that he blocked off that part of the maze, that pathway to go to the treat, and had several different arms going out at different angles from the arm that had previously led to a reward. And what happened was that the rats didn't then go down the arm that most resembled the previously rewarded arm. In other words, they didn't go down the arm of the maze that had the angle closest to the previously rewarded one. Instead, they started pursuing an arm further away, that angled further away, but more directly towards where that treat had been. Suggesting again that rats had developed some sort of spatial representation of the layout of the maze. In other words, they had developed what Tolman called a cognitive map. Again, you could not explain their behavior without making some sort of appeal to an internal representation of the spatial layout. It couldn't be explained through reward associations. So remember that story I started to tell you at the beginning of the lecture about how my dog Bonnie had done something amazing that demonstrated this concept of cognitive maps? Let's take a breather here, and I'll tell you about the rest of that story. So, what is that story that I said I was going to tell you about Bonnie and how she saved my skin while demonstrating a fundamental concept from the history of cognitive psychology? Well, we had only had her for 2 days. In those 2 days, we had walked her here or there in our neighborhood, and then on that second day, I was home alone, and I walked Bonnie about a kilometer away to our local grocery store. I rushed in to get some milk after tying her up to a post. And then I rushed back out, and only thing I found was half a leash tied to the post. She had chewed through it and disappeared. It started to rain, and I desperately walked home shouting, "Bonnie! Bonnie!" everywhere I went. No sign. Finally got home, and she was waiting for me in the yard. Amazing to think about the cognitive processes that had to have happened there. That meant in that those 2 days, the less than 2 days that I had been walking her around town, she had been building up a mental map, a cognitive map of our neighborhood. And she'd been doing this without being rewarded for it. She'd been doing this without getting a treat every time we turned a corner so that she would learn her way. Somehow, she was exhibiting what was called latent learning, this learning process that allowed her to find her way home when she escaped from the grocery store parking lot. Findings of things like cognitive maps were one of a growing number of findings that started to shake the foundations of the behaviorism, of the behaviorist movement. You can't explain these kinds of things without some acknowledgement that there must be some cognitive or mental representation going on. For me, the best part, of course, was not just finding Bonnie,
But realizing that after only 2 days, she realized that our home was a good place to come back to.
Isn't that right, Bonnie? Yes.
Now, in addition to findings from within the field of psychology that seem to demand some reference to internal mental processes, around the 1950s and 1960s, there was a flourishing of findings and influences from outside the field as well. So, for example, Noam Chomsky is still today one of the most towering intellectual figures in the world. He's a linguist at MIT. And he started to point out that the way that children learned to speak and to understand language seemed to be unexplainable by simply a process of being rewarded for saying things right. So, for example, children demonstrated what's known as overgeneralization of grammatical rules. They seem to pick up on certain grammatical rules and then use them in contexts that were incorrect. Even though these rules most of the time would guide them correctly, in some contexts they started to use them incorrectly in ways that they would never have been rewarded for. So, for example, here is a video, I think, of a girl who's, I think she's 3 years old, explaining the plot of Star Wars. And see if you can detect where and when she uses a grammatical rule that in most cases would be correct, but here was not.